Hey guys, so this sentenced metal giant has spent its whole life transporting oil, coal, metal, containers, or passengers, and is speeding up for the last time. This journey will be a short one. The ship will run into the sandy beach at full speed in just a couple of minutes. It looks like an unfortunate whale that decided to throw itself ashore. However, even though we don't understand whales' behavior still, what's happening with these ships is perfectly clear. Tiny people climb onto it like ants using gas torches and hammer drills to start digging in. This is the ship's last months of life. It's simultaneously highly profitable and extremely dangerous work, taking the lives of dozens of people. Now, the life of most ships sailing rivers, seas, and oceans isn't very long, generally just a few decades. Only unique ships that are valuable to humanity in some way end up living longer. The rest are sent for scrap after 30 to 40 years of active use, unless, of course, they sink due to extreme circumstances. Now, at first, the process of taking apart these sentenced veterans looks civilized, and it was profitable for the former ship owners and for the hired dismantling companies. A ship was sent to the dry dock, to the piers, or sometimes just run aground. They were carefully cut into pieces, and most of them were then reused. As usual, there was an accident that changed everything. So in 1960, the Greek cargo ship MD Alpine met misfortune. The ship was met by a rough storm that tossed it on the coast of Sikkotan in Chittagong, Bangladesh, formerly known as Eastern Pakistan. Now, the ship's owners didn't have the resources nor technical ability to return the ship to the water. It was abandoned, and enterprising locals stripped the MD Alpine of everything that had any value at all over the next 5 years. However, they couldn't kill the main piece, the ship hull, which was rusting on the coast of the Indian Ocean. Now, in 1965, a local metal factory owner, in desperate need of materials, took notice of the ship. The ship's remains were bought from the owner, cut into pieces, and sent to electric steelmaking furnaces, where they likely became part of another new and useful metal product. In the early 1970s, a similar operation was repeated with the Pakistani ship Al Abbas, which was irreparably damaged during the Bangladesh War for Independence. The difference was that the Al Abbas was specifically run aground at Chittagong, where workers already had experience in dismantling ships. It was sent to follow in the Greek ship's footsteps, but much more professionally. This was probably when someone came up with an idea that seemed good at first glance, of making ship dismantling a separate business. It was a genius, foolproof idea in many ways. First, the freshly independent Bangladesh didn't have any significant sources of raw goods for its metal industry left, and the demand for the goods in the country was extremely high. Metal scraps would help solve this problem. Metal from ship remains, for example. Second, Bangladesh had a phenomenal amount of cheap labor. The population of the country was already over 70 million in the mid-1970s, and continued rocketing upwards to its current 160 million. Too many of these millions were ready to work in any conditions, without social protection, spitting on safety requirements, or medical care without days off. This was like a gift for developed countries. Third and finally, the natural conditions of Chittagong facilitated the preferred method of ship dismantling. The wide sandy beaches with a gentle slope onto the oceans and high tide made it significantly easier to beach these metal whales sentenced to death on the coast. Hundreds of ship-breaking platforms were built in the comparatively compact 6 to 18 miles of coast. Now, these platforms were, of course, not really platforms. They were just narrow strips of land that were designed to kill their prey. These dismantling centers in Bangladesh, India, and Pakistan leave nothing behind from their ships in a matter of months. The dismantling process is more or less identical independent of the country. Now, in most cases, an old ship's owner sells it to these middlemen. The middlemen often immediately change the ship's name and country, and then send it to auction. Many developed countries in Europe and America forbid ship dismantling under their own flag by unqualified poor workers from South Asia. Then a company buys it at auction that owns one or several platforms somewhere in Iran. Sometimes the ship is chartered for a voyage to the area of its future death, all to make the maximum profit. The sentenced ship delivers its final cargo and is then sent to its platform. The ship thrusts itself aground during high tide at maximum velocity, and then securely settles down during low tide on the sand. Then, the dismantling begins. Hundreds of workers, including miners, climb aboard the ship. First, they remove everything that has any value at all, like chairs and other furniture, remaining equipment, even cables that contain a colored metal, and they empty all the fuel and technical liquids. Then, brigades equipped with gas cutters get to work, cutting the ship into tiny pieces. The process is almost entirely manual. Small pieces of metal are gradually cut off the ship's hull and fixtures that are sent to the ground. They also take the engines, rotors, and everything else that can be reused off. Now, history has shown that almost everything can be useful in the region. The beached whale has only its skeleton left, and the ship's empty spot is left for the next victim. So there are hundreds of ships every year here that bring in millions of tons of cargo, and it's an extremely profitable scheme for former ship owners too. So they not only get rid of their ship that's become old baggage, and the need to conduct technically complex and expensive dismantling procedures in Europe or America, but they also receive their millions of saved dollars. The metal factories are also satisfied, since they receive hundreds of tons of high-quality metal every year. Naturally, the owners of these dismantling beaches make a pretty penny too. There were always unneeded people who, as usual, are those who do physical labor. The very same poor Bangladeshi Indians and Pakistanis who are ready to do such work to escape their poverty. And they really don't have many other options. The industry brings the owners billions and is capable of providing for their hundreds of thousands of suffering workers and their families. And it's not much money. Even the best, most experienced specialists make $10 to $15 per 12-hour day. The lowest rank workers earn significantly less, but there isn't another option that pays for the same for them yet. The dismantling work is also very dangerous. There are many health risks involved. Tragedies happen often caused by gas poisoning, explosions, and fires. The only method used by the workers to maintain safety in separate parts of the ship that have dangerous gases are chickens. Now, if the bird is alive, it means they can work in that area that has oil products or other easily combustible materials. Sometimes the workers fall from great heights, and they don't have insurance. A lot of them work with welding without protective masks, shoes, or even special clothing. Now, the ecological damage from the dismantling isn't as obvious for daily life, but isn't any less damaging. Naturally, in conditions where human health isn't important, nature isn't thought about at all. Now, despite the situation in the sunny beaches of South Asia improving recently, it is still threatening for its inhabitants and the pictures of paradise. This rare beauty is much better than the appearance of helpless, dying giants whose fates were unavoidable. Well, that's all for today. Be sure to leave a like and comment. Let me know what you learned today. And we'll see you again next time.